Greetings, Nephilim, and everyone out there. Although I guess maybe all of you are Nephilim. I don't know. Could be some demons listening as well. How's it going? Welcome to the new era of the Westmarch Workshop. This is episode 101, not to be confused with episode 1. Although it may just be as unprofessional as it was the first time around. In any case, don't worry. None of your progress has been reset for this era. You'll be able to carry all of your items, Westmarch Workshop points, and anything else that you've accrued along the way, dick jokes, clams, all those are coming with you. It may be the dawn of a new day, but we're just the same old two guys that love Diablo and love to play. So what do you say? Hey, hey, let's get the show on the road, eh? Eh? No? Yeah? Nine ball?
Hello?
No? Wow. What a hater. I'm just trying to get my rhymes off. It's been such a long time. And you won't even let me live.
It's been like... No. No, not when they're bad.
You know what?
That's like, I could rhyme like that.
You're trying to... I think we should break up. It was a beautiful thing. First episode after the greatest celebration ever seen by Diablo podcasts. And now you're just... You changed. You're a whole new man on me.
And that's it. Episode 100 was a great remembrance. And episode 101, we're breaking up. And then episode 102 will be... Yeah, episode 102 will be putting the band back together.
Putting the band back together again. All right, well, as long as the drama is scripted and the script carries on, I suppose. Well, we should reveal less of the plot ahead of time, maybe.
Yeah, maybe. Which, damn it, reminds me, pre-show chat talking about Gallivant. They did that too. Never mind. Moving on.
All right, well, welcome everyone to episode 101, titled Metzen, Mosqueira, and More. There's a lot of M's there. Basically, today, we're going to cover some of the old items that we... skipped over since we had the just pure celebration podcast last time around. So there were a couple of news items. We did touch on the Chris Metzen thing, but we'll expound on it a little bit more and also loop it into some other news because it all kind of comes together in a delicious stew. And there's some other stuff along the way too. Some things that looked real and then turned out to be fake, and some changes that happened without maybe everyone noticing, and so much more. So without further ado, Mr. Nine, how have your weeks in gaming been?
It's been pretty good. Still sucked into Legion, I guess, fortunately or unfortunately. it has a lot to offer. It's still keeping my interest. Raids have started, but I haven't really done much of that. I got invited into a friend's raid and did like two bosses, but I had my original experience. I have Mythic Plus dungeons, which are a lot like Greater Rifts.
Nice.
Whereas you have to go through, complete a Greater Rift, and then it will upgrade your key. So that way you can then use it to do a higher level Mythic Plus. So it starts at 2 and, you know, 3, 4, 5, stuff like that. The faster you do it, the better your rewards, as well as it will upgrade your key, so it doesn't, like, you can go from like a 2 straight to a 5, you know, stuff like that, that they've taken over from, you know, Diablo.
Very Diablo-esque.
Yep. My first experience with it wasn't that great, because it was trying to go through and using the in-game tools to find groups, because a lot of people in my guild weren't up to the level to do Mythic Pluses, and it was just bad. people like just rage quitting the group like shortly after the first boss because, oh, we won't make 3 chests, so there's no point in finishing it. You know, it's like, so people are just going through and giving up their key. Or actually, the people that left weren't even giving up their key and just ruining it for everyone else and screwing someone else out of their key. Because if you fail the dungeon, your key gets depleted and you can't use it for loot. You can redo the dungeon to give you your key back as long as you make the timer, but you won't get any loot from that run. as just the sheer amount of rage and just elitism that I was seeing was just bad. Once I actually got more like guildies together and we were just having to like fill like one spot, it started going much nicer, much nicer.
It sounds like it's going to be the kind of thing where, like they learned in Diablo 3, you know, maybe everyone will have to give a key and then everyone will care a little bit more because everyone will have the investment.
That's exactly what I actually was going to go and make as my next point, is that there has to be some detriment for someone to leave the group.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because right now there's nothing. They can, because it's not through like the looking for group tool, there is no penalties. Like if you use the actual like looking for dungeon, if you rage quit out of the dungeon before it's completed, you'll get like an hour long debuff that prevents you from joining any other dungeon group. But with this one, it's just a tool saying, hey, these people are looking for a group. You can message them to see if you can get into the group with them instead of auto-queuing people together. And you get there's nothing preventing people from being complete and total assholes. Because once you start the dungeon, if someone leaves, you can't re-invite someone new in. It's locked specifically to those five people that started it.
Oh, geez.
So one person leaves. Yep. As soon as the first person leaves, that's it. You're done. Bad.
Yeah, that definitely needs a couple of quality of life changes there for sure.
Yeah, but if you actually have like a dedicated group of people that you know going and doing it, it's much better. And you know, going through and they add in different affixes as you go along, and every week it will change, so it will make it, you have to do the pulls differently, and it's different from a Diablo Greater Rift where you just have to go and like kill trash in order to get the boss spawn. You already know where the bosses are, but you have to kill a certain amount of trash along the way in addition to killing all the bosses. So there's some times where it's like, well, we have to pull X number of packs to complete the dungeon. And it's like having to go through and pick and choose without like going and looking up online for the stuff that people have done in the beta. We were just doing it ourselves. And it was cool figuring out, well, which ones can we skip? Which ones do we need to pull? And which ones are the most efficient to pull? And which ones can we pull together? And then once we get to level 4, it makes it so that way every mob that you kill buffs all the other mobs in the group. So it's like you can't pull like double packs.
Huh.
You know, because you'll be murdered by the last mob in the group because it's got like a 200% damage bonus by the end.
All right.
So
that's a cool system.
It was a lot of fun.
It actually reminds me of obviously pulling a lot from Diablo, but also sounds similar to like what they're doing with Hearthstone with the tavern brawls, because they're always a little, you know, there's like a weekly thing that they'll put into the game to let you play the game a little bit differently. Like they might randomize your deck or, you know, have a different archetype or something that's going on. So it almost feels like, you know, they're learning from all their different games and pulling these elements together.
Yeah. Then so far I've been enjoying it. Once I got that dedicated group, I've not tried the little in-game tools to find groups since my like first day of bad karma or something on that one. But other people I've known have been using it and not being, you know, that bad with it.
Maybe it's just that first kind of opening of the floodgates. Now people are chilling out a little.
Mm-hmm. And to explain what I meant, I realize now that I didn't say what three chest means, is that you have a really really flexible timer. It will change depending upon the dungeon. Sometimes it might be 30 minutes, sometimes it might even be 45 minutes that you'll have in order to complete the dungeon and be able to upgrade your key to the next level. So think of it like in a Greater Rift system, you have your 15 minutes to complete the entire rift and kill the boss in order to get your rewards. With the mythic ones, you have to, you know, kill the X amount of trash and kill all the bosses within that time frame to get your key upgraded. No matter when you do it, you'll always be rewarded with loot at the end. But if you do a really good time, you know, say if you have like a 30-minute dungeon and you manage to complete it in 20, you'll get three chests at the end. So you'll actually triple your reward instead of just a single treasure chest. And that will also, you know, skip a couple levels on your key to be upgraded.
Gotcha. Pretty cool stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man. Someday, just might get pulled into that world of Warcraft.
Yeah, of Warcraft. see what you did there. Mm-hmm. And then the only other thing that I've been doing recently and going for a tabletop game, not computer games, is the new Warhammer 40K Gene Stealer Cults. I've never been this excited about a Warhammer release ever, and the hype on this one is real. And I know, like, probably very little people, if anyone, really cares about it besides like a few in chat, so I'll save that one for the after show.
All right. I did see some tweet from you about like a codex or something, and I was like, yeah, sounds cool. But that was as far as I could engage with that tweet.
Yeah.
I like the word codex. All right, moving on. Oh boy.
It's a fun word.
It is. As for myself, I have not been nearly as active in gaming in general. I've been thinking a lot about games. Like, I guess I'm using this time more than anything to just look at the general landscape of what's happening with games and what to expect. Like, the holiday season is coming up quicker than anticipated. And so, you know, a lot of gamers and developers and things should be starting to get some exciting announcements and releases out there. I'm actually still curious how Nerdwords is doing with the whole Call of Duty thing, if he'll actually be able to make it to BlizzCon or not. We haven't checked in with mm-hmm. him yet. But, yeah, I don't know. Just there's a lot of movement in esports. I've been following a lot of that. A lot of professional sports teams, basketball teams, have been purchasing esports teams. So, like, some co-owners of, for instance, like the Golden State Warriors, which is a basketball team for San Francisco and California, they purchased a stake in, I want to say, Team Liquid.
It was Team Liquid.
Team Liquid. And then earlier today, there was another announcement of someone, can't remember now, but they purchased into Immortals and then even Apex, and I think it was Envy or another team. But in any case, just, it's an interesting time because that's going to really change. I think 2017 in specific will look very interesting for esports, because all those gaming teams now will have huge, huge, bigger investments and backings. And I think it could actually make the lives of players obviously much better, but also maybe bring some solidity or some, what's the word I'm looking for? Some realness to esports actually becoming like a more respected
validity
thing. Validity, yeah, there yeah. we go. Yeah, yeah. To be more respected and kind of taken more seriously, I guess. So I'm excited for what continues to go down with that. And also Worlds for League of Legends is starting tomorrow, Thursday, so I'm excited for that. Been reading up on some of the teams. And then playing-wise, I have been playing a little bit of D3, very, very little, and a little bit of Hearthstone as well. Trying to get back into that. And my very first venture into the arena in Hearthstone after, like, I don't know, a 2 year plus break was an 0-3 paladin arena. So I my skills have
nice.
Have not rusted at all, because I was not also good a long time ago. I like lucked into a 12 win arena one time as a paladin and was never ever able to replicate the results. That game is just like too random sometimes.
That's a better story than mine. The best I've done is a 10 win.
Yeah, that's better than average. I think the average for most people is like 4 or 5.
That is my average.
There you go.
Yeah.
Oh geez. So we.
It really sucks when you when you draft like the perfect deck, but then every other person that you fight against has something that's even better.
Yes, you're like, all right, I finally got one. It has like some legendaries in there. It curves out well.
Yeah, I've got like two legendaries, perfect curve. I have everything that I need to. I have 3 board clears, lots of card draw, and then it's like you go through and you play the person, and then it's just like turn 1 Dust Devil, and then like they're okay. It's like, okay, I don't have anything to counter that right now, but I'm good. And then, like, turn 2, they're just coin Rockbiter. Fuck you.
All of a sudden, wait, why do I only have 3 life left? What happened there?
Mm-hmm.
I thought I was going to win this game. Yeah, that's the ups and downs of Hearthstone, for sure. It's still such a fun game, though. And I think I think they do a good job of updating it pretty often. But some people who play every day might say otherwise.
Yeah,
for us casuals on the outside, feels good.
I've read about some of the changes. I don't know whether they're already applied or they're upcoming today, but it made me sad. They're nerfing Yogg.
Yeah.
I don't even play him, and it makes me sad because that's one of the funnest things to watch.
Right. Right. I think the way that they did it, and we're like becoming a Hearthstone podcast now, but I think the way that they did it, it should have a good effect in terms of the life of tournaments, because I would imagine that since they're, it almost became more random the way that they changed it. So I think it's going to be less reliable as a kind of win condition for tournament decks. So you might see more standard stuff in tournaments, which is, I think, good for people watching tournaments. But it should still maybe be a fun card to play in casual, like pickups or against friends or whatever, or on the ladder, because I think it should still, like, if you want to just randomly say Yogg can win or lose me the game, you should still be able to play it and do decently well. It just, like, now if it kills itself or silences itself, it's just like, boom, effect over.
Chain ends.
Yeah. All right, well, I hope all the like three Hearthstone players who are listening really enjoyed that segment there. That was for you guys. All jokes aside, we do have some Diablo news here. But first, we would like to tease the fact that we did launch a contest for a virtual ticket for free from an awesome listener who wanted to remain anonymous. That was launched on episode 99, and we gave you guys a couple of weeks to get your answers in. We got some answers. Some were wrong, unfortunately, and then some were right. So at the end of this show, near the wrap-up of this show, we will reveal the whole who put in the right answers and then randomly draw the person who wins live on stream. So look forward to that. All right. And then diving into the news, let's bring up again the Chris Metzen retirement situation. So as we talked about briefly on episode 100, Chris Metzen is hanging up his guns, walking off the estate, taking Tracer with him, or maybe not, I don't know. But he's not going to be doing stuff for Blizzard anymore, unfortunately. And in fact, he's not going to be doing anything for anyone besides his family, as far as I am able to discern from this post, which I have on the screen here for you guys.
Though he has said that he will continue to be the voice of Thrall.
Ah, there you go. So I guess that means future expansions of WoW, he will lend his voice to it?
Yes.
Okay.
So anything involving Thrall, he'll at least still be involved in that, which also makes me wonder that if they continue to do the Warcraft movies, is he eventually going to play Thrall?
Ooh.
Because he is Thrall.
He is, through and through. Thrall, you might say Thrall is him.
I don't know. At this point, that very well could be. I'd accept that one.
But I mainly wanted to bring up this retirement post specifically because I really liked kind of the Metzen story, where he came from. I think it might be inspirational for a lot of us on the outside who would love to someday work for Blizzard or have dreams of, you know, taking our role with these games further. And just the fact that, you know, he really kind of tried whatever he could to get into Blizzard. You know, he didn't start out crafting stories and being the boss that he is and that everyone loves him for. And he credits one of his kind of breakout inspirations and storytelling skills from D&D, which I thought was really interesting. I have a friend who is super into Dungeons and Dragons right now and is actually, he's dungeon mastering, he's DMing one campaign for his high school friends, and then he's also involved in another one. And I don't know, it's kind of cool to think that it's something you just do for a hobby, for fun, but it ended up essentially crafting a career for Chris Metzen, and it might just do the same for you. So I'll just read this quick excerpt where he says, "My only real training before joining Blizzard was the long-running D&D campaign I had with my closest friends, Sam, Mike P, Daniel, and Mikey C. You know who you are, boys. Hamro! Building ideas, vast worldscapes, characters, and plot lines with my friends was my first great love. I lived for it. It was a safe space amid the tension and change of some rough teenage years. The grand refuge of D&D was a glorious meeting of minds and imaginations where I felt I truly belonged. It was a space where friendship and imagination were inextricably linked. The sharing of ideas on the fly, the crazy, unexpected turns that the players would take, It stretched our imaginations in ways we'd never have dreamt of on our own. I loved how role-playing through adventures taught us so much about each other, and more often than not, ourselves. Imagining together helped us make sense of the crazy world we were growing up in and made us stronger together. I wouldn't really understand the depth of it for many years, but I had learned an important truth from my friends back then. Creativity is relational. And looking back at my years at Blizzard, I see now how profoundly this idea has shaped my career. I see how profoundly my friends and coworkers at Blizzard's have shaped me as a person. And then he goes on to continue. But I think this is something that even without being, you know, you don't have to play D&D to have this experience, I don't think. Because I would say even the relationships that we have, like you and I, you know, fostered through first meeting in-game and through like the Diablo podcast and things like that, you know, it's... These worlds, I guess it's almost an extension of him getting that through D&D. He then gave it to us by creating the worlds that we met each other through, whether it be Diablo, whether it be Warcraft, whether it be Starcraft, you know, anything that Blizzard now offers. He's kind of allowing those same sorts of friendships to develop, which I thought was just really cool, like the handing down of it.
Yeah. And I mean, he's not the only person to have gone through and like credited like Dungeons and Dragons. Vin Diesel like contributes his entire acting career to Dungeons and Dragons, and he even wrote the foreword in, I think it was the 50th anniversary edition that they did. He wrote the foreword for that.
Ah, I think I do remember you telling me about that one time. Yeah, so it's, I mean, it's like this. I don't know. I would almost call it like magic, although it's not Magic the Gathering, by the way. Different things.
Yeah, but it is something, because it's like you have to, if you want, you can always like go through and do like a D&D campaign. You walk into the dungeon, you kill 30 goblins, and then that's it. You know, you grab the loot and move on to kill 30 more goblins. You know, but the ones that you remember, the ones that are like important, have like backstory. And I've run some Dungeons and Dragons campaigns, and I've written like so much backstory and lore and other crap about things that no one will ever see the light of day, you know, or no one will ever, you know, read about or know, or just because, oh, well, they might talk to this person, and so I have to give them a backstory. And then in their backstory, you know, I reference this village, so then I now have to go and put that village on the map and then write, you know, well, what is that village known for? What do they produce? And, you know, it goes on, and you could spend days going and just, you know, writing and imagining the world that you're going through and building off of just, like, a couple of characters.
Right. And it's the kind of thing where it doesn't, you're doing it, but it doesn't even necessarily feel like it, just because you're building all those pieces like simultaneously, but almost separately at the same time.
Yeah. And, you know, when he's going through and talking about like the long running D&D campaign, I can only imagine, you know, like the vast number of, you know, in jokes or things. Cause it's like, I'm sure that talking about, like it's a relational type thing, and how you can like build off of others. Because if you hand off like a campaign from like one person to another, and you each kind of like help and build and craft this world, you know, you might take something that someone else created and make a little change, and they can go be like, I never thought of that, you know, that to like take this particular NPC in this direction, or to add some other usefulness to it. Or you'll just sometimes find that, you know, your players will come up with a solution to the problem that you couldn't even think that is, you know, that wouldn't even be, you know, like you never even thought that they could do this. Like I didn't actually think about like collapsing that pillar to take in the whole room or something like that, you know?
Yeah. It's kind of like how the developers will say, oh yeah, we didn't realize players would, you know, use that skill that way, or create this build, or, you know, the world that you create, even though you think you know everything about it, or you've shaped enough of it to figure out like, oh yeah, I imagine if they do this, then this will happen, then this, blah, blah, blah. But there's always still going to be ways that people surprise you, especially when it's like your friends who are like super intuitive or creative or innovative. That's just another awesome part, I think, of kind of finding your community where you truly feel like you can be yourself, you know?
Yeah. And that you can share your ideas, you know, like, because we all have those like stories or things that we kind of like, you know, keep in the back of our head. You know, it's your little fan fiction, you know, for your monk or your demon hunter, you know, about where they came from or what they did. But you don't feel comfortable like going through and talking about it with your friends at the gym. Or maybe you do, you know, but it's like just having that little safe space to share those ideas.
Exactly.
But
Yeah, man. So, definitely a sad loss.
yeah, I think that there's one of those ones where it's like the couple of the times that I've applied to Blizzard unsuccessfully on all of them so far, but there's something that Chris Metzen said during one of the BlizzCon openings where he's going and talking about like when he went through and did a, I think he before he worked at Blizzard, he was part of a band, and that
Nice.
he went there to like go through and check it out, and by the time that he left, he was like, I have to work here, I have to have a job. It was just that one line that he said, like, I would sweep your floors
Yeah.
to work here, you know. And it's just like that's the one thing that's always resonated with me, and I've wanted to put it in my cover letter, but I've never had the guts to actually go through and do it. But it's just like I want to put that in and just say I would literally to take, you know, it's just to take a cue, you know, from your vice president. I literally would sweep your floors just to work for your company.
Yeah, man. The dream is real, you know, just to be a part of it all. Just keep the fingers crossed and keep trying. All right. And then related to that, we also back on September 11th, oh, kind of an ominous date there, we learned of some news of Josh Mosqueira. It turned out that, of course, we knew he had left Blizzard. He had stepped down from game directing for Diablo 3, and he had said in his tweets and kind of whatever he was letting us know through that there was something in the future, but it was yet to be determined or announced, and we would find out. Well, that day came, and we found out. It turns out that he has joined a brand new studio called Bonfire Studios. And there is actually some star power from ex-Blizzard employees here, wouldn't you agree, Mr. Nine?
Oh yes, that there is. So like what is it? It's Josh Mosqueira, Rob Pardo, and
Nick
dang
Carpenter.
it, Nick Carpenter. I
Yep.
was trying to remember without actually going and pulling up the web page. Yeah. But they're going through and they've formed, you know, the Bonfire Studios, and they did Rob Pardo did a interview with the New York Times where he talked about wanting to, after leaving Blizzard, wanting to replicate what Hearthstone did,
Yes.
going and actually showing what the power of what a strong small group of dedicated developers could do. By wearing like different hats, you know, kind of taking it back to like the old school days of when your de entire development team might only be like 7 people, and the guy that does your coding is also, you know, designing your barrels, you know, stuff like that. So it's just where everyone's going through and doing multiple things on the team, but it's just a small, cohesive, close-knit group, so that way they can get changes out quickly and they can develop faster.
Yeah, there's right now is like a core group of 5 developers, and some serious star power, like we mentioned, you know, between Rob Pardo and Nick Carpenter, and then 2 other guys. One of them, I think, had a heavy hand in developing some of the Battle.net stuff that we utilize the today, and then a guy who was also pretty big on some mobile stuff. So, you know, people are wondering what the first project from this place will be. And in one of those articles that Rob had been interviewed in, he was saying, oh, we're not even thinking about a game yet or a genre or anything. Right now, we're just doing a lot of brainstorming. We're getting, you know, more bodies in the door. And basically, we're just gonna, you know, we're not limiting ourselves to any sort of game, but we do at least wanna consider mobile as a platform. We think it will be PC. And most of all, they really want it to be community-based, community involved. That's kind of their idea for the studio is, you know, Bonfire, like everyone gathered around, everyone kind of huddled up and sharing stories and things. So they really want to make sure their games are going to build solid communities where people can come and find friends and enjoy each other's time spent playing an awesome game. So, I mean, there's a lot of anticipation for what these guys can create because, I mean, when you have those sorts of dudes to start, and then you know who knows who else they pick up. I mean, it could be the next Diablo ARPG that comes out of there. I don't know, man.
Yeah, I mean, they have a kind of a broad swath of experience. You know, when you look at all the titles that they collectively have done, I mean, even like Josh, he has a pretty long list of games that he's worked on. You know, everything from, you know, shooters to ARPGs. You have
True.
MMOs and all other sorts of things that they could do. As a small studio, and just the nature of MMOs recently, I don't expect them to do, you know, something along those lines, but probably something like I'd expect maybe an action or a shooter
I could see
as
that.
one of their first ones too. Yeah.
Yeah. And as Thunderclaw's noting, there was a little piece of news as well where the Battle.net name, as we once knew it, is being retired slash no longer used because I guess Blizzard believes that their branding is a little confusing between Blizzard products and Battle.net. They just want everything to be Blizzard. So we don't yet know what the future, what we will call that Battle.net launcher or whatever, but it will not be called Battle.net anymore, which is kind of sad if you think about, the many years that we've been utilizing that name in tech.
Yeah, shortly after they went through and announced that, somebody shared something on Twitter of just like the first screen you see that drops you into the chat room in StarCraft, the original StarCraft. And that was my first experience with like the BattleNet, you know, going online and seeing stuff. And that was just like just seeing a picture of that screen, and the first thing that came to my mind was just the metal ka-chunk, ka-chunk of like going and swapping screens and going in to like play a game or find a game. And it's just it was
You were feeling the
the
nostalgia.
memories, the nostalgia. The
Nope.
nostalgia hit hard that day.
I mean, I guess it's probably a change for the better. Usually you want to have everything be familiar. I mean, I could see both sides where people were pointing to things like Valve and Steam. Like there's a relational thing there because Steam comes out of Valve's, and so that's maybe why they use that name, but they're still different kind of brands. Like EA has something that's named completely, like, was it like Nexus or something? I don't know. But there are a bunch
Origin.
of Origin, there you go. But yeah, a bunch of
Yeah.
companies have their kind of launchers or programs that don't necessarily n line up name-wise. But I mean, I don't know. Maybe Blizzard is going to lead the way to, we'll see all the others also reorganize their systems and naming conventions.
Yeah, there has to be some sort of reason for them to go and change, you know, that long history of experience, and tying it back into the actual what we're supposed to be a Diablo show. I do believe Diablo 1 was the very first game to use the BattleNet interface.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, because they Warcraft 2, they when it launched did not have access to BattleNet, but then they redid it. I think it was when they came out with the expansion for it. It added in BattleNet.
Well, there you go.
Right, but I do believe it was D1 that was the first BattleNet game for Blizzard.
It always starts with Diablo, because
Yep.
it's obviously the best and most important game. Tying,
Obviously.
obvi, tying back into the, we just kind of meandered down the Battle.net path there. But one thing I did want to tie back in, because we're talking about Josh, who was the game director for D3. We then happened upon, at that same time that we found out he was leaving, the announcement, or not really the announcement, but the posting of the game director position on Blizzard's career page. And at the time, it was for an unannounced project. But just today, like maybe a few hours before we started up here, someone noted on Reddit that they were looking at the careers page, and that game director position has now been moved back to the Diablo section and no longer mentions anything about like unannounced project or the brand new game, and so people are like, what does this mean? You have any
Yeah.
thoughts?
Yes.
Oh, okay,
I don't think it
go.
means anything.
Okay.
Yeah. No, it's not even that they moved it back to the Diablo position. It always was under the Diablo listing in the directory. It just had in, you know, parentheses to the side, unannounced project.
Oh,
Now
okay.
they've removed that, and it just says game director instead of game director, unannounced project. It is also the last remaining position to be filled on the Diablo team that they have posted at the moment. All the other unannounced project positions have been filled. Now it's just game director is the last one that's there. And, you know, this could be one of those things where it's like, well, technically, you know, as the game director, the leader of Team 3, you know, Team 3 is still working on Diablo 3 and whatever this unannounced project is. So it's not just for that. They would still have some handling and dabbling of Diablo 3 content and updates that will be coming down the line to whatever we see this unannounced project is. It could also just be them trying to control the hype factor a little bit, where they did all this hiring of these very high level senior conceptual positions for an unannounced project that might be a few years before it ever sees the light of day. And so they want to tone down the hype on that a little bit by removing any references further to that unannounced project until it does get announced, or until they actually need to get ready for the announcement and then build up the team with a lot more hiring. So yeah, that... I think this one is more for just somewhat publicity, more so than it actually meaning. I was talking with Dreadscythe earlier before the show, and it was like tinfoil hat. He was saying like his tinfoil hat theory was that they hired a game director for the unannounced project, but then they still have something to do with Diablo 3, so they're going to hire another game director just for D3. And so it's just like, yeah, that's very tinfoil hat.
See, I could buy into that, but I also think about business logistics, and the position of game director is kind of like your, you know, like a pretty high profile position. So I'd imagine it also costs a lot to have a game director. And so if you don't really plan to, like you said, there could be some things down the pipeline still for D3, like, you know, minimal to major patches or something like that. But I would imagine that's something that Wyatt could still be handling as sort of like the patch lead or team lead or whatever you want to say. Like he could be like the game director in absentia or something. But I don't know. You also could, you could argue, I hadn't really thought of that angle, but it kind of makes sense. I more like the tinfoil hat theory of, you know, as soon as they pull down game director as a filled position, like it no longer being up there, like the internet will lose its mind. So yeah, maybe they are, like you said, trying to like kind of avoid that shitstorm, for lack of a better word. And maybe that's part of, they wanted to get this person in there. It's about a month out before BlizzCon. Maybe they bring them up to speed on some stuff. And maybe this is me now starting to, even though I said I wouldn't get involved in any of this hyping up of BlizzCon for announcements, maybe they bring out that person just to be like, hey, I'm the game director on the unannounced project. All right, see ya. And now we know, like, and I'm leaving. I won't be at the venue. Don't find me. But just to, like, say, hey, by the way, like, this thing is happening. Something is happening. I mean, I don't know. The tinfoil hats are strong, though. The Reddit peanut gallery has been trying to throw theories out all day.
Yeah, yeah. That one, I imagine, probably will continue to have quite a bit of activity for another day or two. But yeah, I still just see it as it's nothing more than really just kind of like a PR move. It's still for the same position. It's still going to have the same like requirements and all that stuff. But just they want to not be referencing that unannounced project again unless they have to.
Yeah, I don't. One thing I was considering when you were putting that out there for the first time was, if they wanted a game director for regular Diablo, Diablo 3, I guess I'm calling that regular Diablo at this point, unhyped Diablo, I don't know. I would imagine that actually while they're looking for this unannounced project game director, they would also potentially be considering like candidates who were good, but maybe not exactly a fit for what they wanted for the future, to also be like, hey, well, we still want someone for the helm of Diablo 3. Would you consider that? So I would be surprised if that they weren't kind of doubling their output by interviewing, kind of like looking at those interviewees for both positions at the same time.
Yeah. That is a possibility, but I think it would go back to what you were saying, where someone of that title probably does cost quite a bit on the payroll in order to go through and have them on. So I don't think that they would have like a game like Diablo 3, which is now kind of go through and they're going to be doing like little tweaks and updates here and there, add in some new items, fix a couple of skills, but they're not going to do, I don't foresee them doing anything too big, like a new Kunai's Cube anytime soon, or at least not frequently. And so that's not going to require like a game director in order to go through and oversee, does this fit into the design paradigm that we have for the game? Does this work with the world and such? Like the core group that they still have there working on the game can handle and make those decisions without having like a director for oversight. Or if they get a game director for Team 3, that even though the focus will be on the unannounced project, can still go through and sign off on the check sheet for the other stuff. So that's what I would see. That there's just going to be like the one singular game director for Team 3.
Word, I am with you there. All right. Did you happen to get hooked by a hoax?
Nope.
All right.
Mm-mm.
Well, good for
Nope.
you, because some people weren't so lucky. There was a for a very brief moment in time between this episode and last episode, a website that existed titled Diablo2HD.com that supposedly was announcing, without fully announcing, the countdown to BlizzCon, where all would be revealed for Diablo 2 HD remake, and everyone ran with it. Some people, I think, to their credit, were like, this seems kind of janky. Like you saw it. How did you feel about kind of the quality of it? What was on the page and how did you feel about it?
Well, it definitely did look like a website that would have been created when D2 was popular, or when it first launched.
Was like GeoCity style.
Yeah, it was. It's like people were going through and talking about, oh, well, it's registered, through GoDaddy, and this is like the who is and all this information, and the IP address points a different directory than what all of other Blizzard websites are registered on, and all those other types of, very, very elaborate, intricate internet techie mumbo jumbo type stuff. And I'm just looking at it like Blizzard has never just like flat out announced a game in any of their teasers, which is what that website was doing.
Yeah, that was kind
Because
of the
it was,
strongest, yeah,
it was
evidence.
Diablo2HD.com in a countdown to BlizzCon. It's like, when they were even for Diablo 3 itself, when they were counting down to its announcement back in 2008 at the Worldwide Invitational in Paris, it was just like an ice wall with runes that every day started melting, or for the Reaper of Souls was just a stone archway that we would later, learn that was the ruins of Corvus with a, and then would say, the little comment. I forget specifically what it said, but it was something like Death's Wings or something along those lines. It was part of the prophecy of the end of times. And they are giving like little hints, but they never flat out say what it is that they're announcing. They've never done that. So why would they go through and do it with this? And I'm someone that does believe into the hype of the rumors of a D2 HD remake. That's something that I do have some investment in, but that website, no, total hoax, not Blizzard whatsoever.
Yeah, it was eventually confirmed by PC Gamer reaching out to a contact at Blizzard, and the quote from the article is great because he said, "I reached out to Blizzard to ask about the site and was told bluntly, this isn't ours." It's just like not even like a, well, man, like no, that get that shit out of here. That's not ours. We claim nothing on this. But I think maybe the saving grace for people who were hooked by this or at least wanted it to be real is that it technically still does not rule out some sort of Diablo 2 HD or improvement or bringing into the modern realm of computers announcement, because that really seems more plausible. We've been discussing over the last few shows with this kick on the 20th anniversary and a lot of looking back rather than looking forward, it seems more likely than a new game announcement that something might happen with Diablo 1 or Diablo 2 instead.
Mm-hmm. Now, if I was Blizzard and I was actually working on a D2 HD remake, and then someone went through and did that hoax, what my response wouldn't have been, "That isn't ours," was just been like, "Oh, we haven't made any announcements about our D2 HD remake," and then just leave it at that, you know. Oh, wait, what'd you say?
Right, every word of that would have been torn apart. Like, they could have said, "Did not," but then they used a comma and an apostrophe. What does it mean? Oh my god, that would have been so sick. That would have been amazing.
And then just not say anything from that point forward. You know, it's like, did they just announce D2 HD remake?
They don't do that, right? They never do that, right?
Yep.
That would have been something else, man. Oh. Yeah, we'll see.
The internet would have exploded.
Oh, for sure. Break the internet, right? Yeah. Like Kim Kardashian and then Diablo 2 HD. The only things that could do it. Likely compatriots, obviously. Let's loop back into some of your World of Warcraft talk, because there's apparently coming attractions for Diablo tie-ins there as well. I haven't followed this since the post kind of came about, but people were data mining the 7.1 patch for World of Warcraft, which I guess is the return to Karazhan, and they noted that there was a Diablo event in there. Mm-hmm. You know more about this?
I haven't really found anything more specifically about like the Diablo event itself, but they have found a whole bunch of items. So there is going to be something special that they're doing for the Diablo anniversary. And what's interesting is like all these items are actually like Diablo 2, not Diablo 1, which it's the franchise's 20th anniversary. It's Diablo 1's 20th anniversary, but you know, it's not a significant date for D2. But it's, you know, things like the Herodric Cache, the Stone of Jordan, you know, things like that. It does have, like, the Scroll of Town Portal, which is from, you know, both the games. But it does also have a Tome of Town Portal, which is D2, not D1. So it's got a lot of interesting little notes that's mainly, although most people, when they think of Diablo, they do think of, like, old school Diablo. They think of D2, not Diablo 1. And then when they think of D2, they're actually thinking of, you know, Lord of Destruction. And not base Diablo 2. Yeah.
Right.
But it's, yeah, the thing that I like the most that they found is like a toy that you can get called a 12-string guitar, which when you use it changes the background ambiance music to something from D2. They believe it was like 6 different musical tracks that they found, and most of them are both the Diablo 1, Diablo 2 version of Tristram, but they also have the Diablo 3 Tristram, as well as some other tracks.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Hmm.
And so they've got some interesting things that they're going and rewarding in there. We have no idea how they'll come about, how you earn them, or what they're going to be doing to kick off this Diablo anniversary.
So this patch isn't live yet?
No, it's on the PTR. It'll still be a couple of months.
Okay. Yeah, I was kind of curious what the turnaround was for WoW patches, if they stayed on PTR as long as Diablo ones or shorter. Or sounds like it's still some time, though. Like, even post-BlizzCon?
Yeah, 7.1 probably will not go up until post-BlizzCon.
Interesting. Okay. But before the end of 2016...
Maybe, probably.
Okay. I'm just kind of trying to figure out then why, you know, why would they put something like this in there? The timing would have to make sense for it to matter, I guess, to people who would notice or who would care, perhaps. Because if it's celebrating the 20th anniversary, then you would imagine it should land in the same year that the 20th anniversary would be celebrated. But we also are getting kind of close to that time window where we all know, you know, Blizzard kind of shuts down.
They have until December 31st.
Realistically, more like December 7th.
It's like, yeah, no. Well, I mean, they could launch the patch, you know, beforehand and have all those items and add it in the update, because the 20th anniversary is December 31st.
I see what you're saying. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Word. I guess we shall see.
Mm-hmm.
You'll have to let us know as a resident World of Warcraft expert.
Yeah. The other interesting thing that I found that we actually was data mined, I believe it was also on MMO Champion, is that they have charms being added to World of Warcraft. I don't know if it's just like a thing during the anniversary or if it's a permanent whatever, but it's just like the D2 charms. You keep it in your bag and it gives you a bonus to your stats.
Oh, wow.
Yep.
That's kind of crazy. Isn't bag space like really important in World of Warcraft though?
It can be. It can be. Not as important as it is in Diablo.
Interesting.
Well, every single piece of equipment only takes up a single slot, and you know, you have your backpack, which is like 18 slots, and then I think it's four other bags or five other bags that can be up to 28. So you have a lot of bag space. I think like, you know, if you have nothing but the 28 slot bags, your inventory is like as big as your cash is in Diablo. And then you have your, then in World of Warcraft, you have your bank, which is even bigger.
I'm just waiting, like, all right, we'll revisit this in like 3 months after the patch is out and everyone's bags are just full of charms. And they're like, we need more bag space.
Need more bag space. that was the thing with going through and like farming in D2. You know, it's like, well, I'm going to have this many, you know, charms and stuff, and I'm going to leave this 4x4 area free, so that way I can go and loot things.
Mm-hmm. And, like, you might have a spot for your cube, and then, like, a tome of town portal.
Yep. Or it's like, you have your cube, and your tomes are in the cube to free up space.
Right?
Yep.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, so that way you can go through and then, you know, pop the book out and then use it. Because you only needed that small little space, because the majority of stuff that the bosses would drop is going to be garbage. But you might have those couple items that you'll go through and grab to see if they're of any use or worth being traded.
Exactly.
It's not like now where you actually will pick up your yellows and blues to disenchant to use the mats for. You know, it's like you'll see like, well, I do need like a particular like blue pair of vampiric gloves to roll in the cube for this, or, you know, I'm gonna go and pick up all of the, you know, dark gray, you know, breastplates because I need a 5-socket chest piece, you know, things like that. But yeah,
this is the moment where I admit to you that on the weekends I've had more free time, so I've been kind of like sitting here like, I want to play a game, what game should I play? And I have had a hankering for Diablo 2, but here we go. I'm admitting that I'm not playing Diablo 2. I'm reserving that feeding of that need because I kind of believe that I'll have more incentive to play Diablo 2 post BlizzCon.
I strangely agree.
Like, I don't know if I'm just like willing it to happen because, you know, it's like, well, if I don't play now, then surely they will feel my desire to play and be more willing to reward me by doing something with Diablo 2. But it's almost like I want to do it, but if something crazy is going to happen with D2, then I would almost feel like I not burned myself out, but kind of like spoiled some of my future fun by diving back in before it's all glitzy and glamoury.
I'm going to want to go back and like actually like beat Diablo 1 for the first time, you know, for the 20th anniversary. That's something that we could do, like go and do like a stream of us playing D1.
Wow, can you even get D1 on Windows 10? Like, is that possible?
I don't think so.
I still have a really old MacBook, and maybe I could like find a way to run it or something.
Yeah, a virtual machine, get virtual machine running, and pop up a Windows 98.
Oh my God, that would be fun though. That would definitely be fun.
Yeah. All I know is stay away from the yellow zombies.
And the yellow snow.
And don't eat the yellow snow.
Well, yes. BlizzCon is happening. Like I mentioned, very close, very soon. It's actually 5 weeks from this Friday, so get hype or start the hype train. One thing that we found out, and we should continue to find out more as the weeks trundle on, because soon we'll know who the music guest is, what the exclusive goodies that you can actually buy will be on the website and also at the convention itself. What the panels will be, what the Diablo floor space looks like, and how much bigger or smaller it is than the nearest bathroom. But we also found out what the in-game goodies will be. Don't shake your head. What the in-game goodies will be for those who have tickets to the actual BlizzCon or virtual tickets. And there's some exciting stuff, but of course, you only care about Diablo, so you should know that we are getting a Diablo pet. And it's on screen for you right
Literal
now.
Diablo pet,
Yes, not just a
not a
pet
pet
from
in
Diablo.
Diablo, but
Yes.
Diablo as a pet.
And again, continuing on the 20th anniversary sort of celebration, this is the old school version of Diablo because he's kind of gone through a few facelifts and makeup changes. This is Diablo 1 Diablo.
That it is.
So, more evidence for this remake, hype, upgrade,
Yep, hype
classics.
about something, but it is pretty awesome, pretty interesting to go through and see a little old school Diablo hanging out there that we get. Though I have to say, as much as I love being able to have like Diablo as a pet while playing Diablo and killing Diablo, it wasn't the in-game goodie that I was most excited about.
Which one are you
The
most excited about?
StarCraft 2 one.
But you don't even know what it is.
Exactly.
Could be anything.
It's just, yeah, it's just it's like the first to unlock a fun new piece of upcoming StarCraft 2 content. Like, what does that mean?
It could
Is
be.
it are they gonna have like purchasable skins that they're gonna do in StarCraft so you can like reskin some of your units? Or is it that you're gonna get like the first download to the next set of like, Nova missions, which as to continue the ongoing joke, I still have not played.
Very good. It could just be a pack of memes. And then how excited are you?
Extremely excited. I love memes.
God damn it. Well, it could be a pack of something you don't like. Like what if it's a pack
Don't let your
of
memes be dreamed.
what if it's a pack of spoonfuls of cinnamon?
I never tried that challenge, but I could probably do
You're the worst. In any case, I like well, we should also go over all the other things in case there are people here who like all Blizzard games. So for Heroes of the Storm, you also get a Nexus Tiger mount, which kind of reminds me of the saber-toothed tiger from Power Rangers, the Yellow Ranger would transform.
Yeah.
The Hearthstone goodie is a welcome in, INN card back. So that's exciting. More card backs for you. Like mentioned, the Diablo 20th anniversary pet of Diablo 1 Diablo. Overwatch gets a Bastion skin, BlizzCon 2016. So there's some like tagging of the BlizzCon branding on there. And World of Warcraft Legionnaire Murky and Knight Captain Murky for pet battles. That's very exciting. My favorite personally is the Nexus Tiger. Because I like to believe in things that I can see.
And you can see that.
Yeah, right in front of me.
Okay. Yep, it's right there.
Whereas Mystery Gift could be it could be poop. They could give you poop. They could give you the poop that the Nexus Tiger pooped out. Then.
This is possible. That's a thing. And if it's like a poop portrait, I would probably use it.
It's like the emoji, the smiley
Just
face.
it's like just so that way I am shit at this game.
I got shit here. Look at that. His icon even matches. Oh my god. You're out of control. Okay, one more news topic. Let's do it before we lose our minds here. Like we mentioned, I think we mentioned this, but in case you haven't noticed, Diablo, BlizzPro, we're trying our best to cover the news as the items come out, but of course things are pretty slow these days in terms of exciting and interesting things happening. But that has not stopped some of our members from creating and thinking outside of the box for things that could happen with Diablo 3, potential changes, looking at systems. And so one of our resident guys who we celebrated last week with his, or 2 weeks ago, with his awesome upgrade to our layover, overlay, I always do that, to our overlay, and the graphics and stuff, he also loves to write. So he came up with his second entry in his Developer Hell series on Paragon, A Tale of Two Cities. And we have a couple of points that we wanted to potentially take away and or discuss on here, but it's something that we've obviously talked about quite a bit over the course of the show, and something that viewers and listeners have written in to let us know that they also have their own ideas for Paragon. So, Nine, in terms of the article here, were there any things in particular that you pulled out or things you wanted to refute or thumbs up? Nineball?
Sorry, you broke up a little bit there for me.
Oh, I was asking if there was anything in here that you wanted to refute, thumbs up, thought was good, thought was bad.
No, yeah. I do like kind of like the idea of maybe going in, taking some of like some of the kick out of the Paragon system and putting it back into the itemization. His idea on that.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, because when it comes down to it, it really is like the core problem with the Paragon system is that is like the end game with the Diablo 3 now. So it's all about not who can get the best items, but who can grind for the longest, who can grind the most and get the most, you know, Paragon points that will allow them to achieve like the higher runs.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing because I remember when Josh was talking about kind of the invention of loot 2.0, right? Like the focus was we want drops to be exciting again. We want you guys to be out in the world finding your legendaries rather than being on the AH buying them. We want items to matter. And they at first did a really good job of that because they upped the drop rates. You know, we were getting sets that mattered and the powers on them were becoming to be better and better as they iterated through them. But then there was this weird turning point where Greater Rifts came in. And I guess this is kind of the tale of what we've talked about previously, where you have all these systems that build on each other. But sometimes when you tweak one, you inadvertently make the other not as good. So I think when they realized that people wanted to do Greater Rifts and wanted to feel rewarded more for doing Greater Rifts, and this is something that Dread does bring up, it was kind of one of the things that ballooned experience in Diablo 3. And as such, people started to get to these crazy levels of Paragon where, to your point, items really stopped mattering as much as they used to.
Yeah. And then, because it's, I think it's also like you've seen kind of like an extension of that where they went through and it's like they wanted to, for those people that go and play, you know, full bore hardcore, you know, with lowercase h, they want to add in. They added in ancients, so that way, you know, if you go through and you find your set and it rolls well, well then there's not much in the item game for you and it's just going and grinding paragons, and that's before paragon levels got, you know, ridiculous. But we're going to add in ancients, so now you can still find something of an upgrade after you fully geared out. There's still better items for you to find, and it'll take you longer to fully gear out those ancients. And then they added in you know, the despair, so that way you could augment the gear, and then, you know, well, you've got your gear, now you've got the ancient, now you can go through and put the augment on it for even higher, and if you grind long enough, you can put an even higher gem into it to increase its stats even further. So it gave you like that progressional grind, all basically to try and coincide with and make the items continue to stay relevant while you're just sitting there grinding for paragon levels.
Exactly. But it was kind of like trying to put the toothpaste back into the tube, you know? At that point, we had already gone to the point where people could get Paragon 1000, you know, in the first week of playing a hardcore lowercase h Diablo 3. Just putting in the hours and getting higher and higher and higher and higher. And then by the end of the season, we're seeing people with 3,000 paragons in season. And it still would just add to the fact of, oh yeah, I can also bolster my items, rather than the items being bolstered offsetting lower paragon levels. At the end of the day, it still mattered. Paragon was still king. Whoever had the highest paragons still had the best advantage, because they were going to have that much more main stat, that much more percentage chance to defeat one greater rift higher than you could ever get to, or two or three or four. So it was a weird kind of, we want to fix the system, but we've already broken the system to the point where any of our fixes are just adding to the problem, or at least not. It's like a net zero gain of decreasing the importance of Paragon. Like, you can never really take it back.
Yeah. It's after you hit Paragon 800, that 5 stat per level doesn't seem like a lot, but, you know, every couple hundred levels, you know, every couple thousand of your main stat that you get, it just adds so much damage potential on that you can just jump that one higher. I can now complete, you know, I got 400 more Paragon levels, I'll jump one higher. And I got 400 more, my damage has increased enough where I'll jump one higher.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah, so... Sorry, go ahead. Didn't mean to cut you off.
Nope, go ahead. That was pretty much the end of my point.
All right, I was just going to say that, you know, one of the main ways that people have talked about moving around that, besides just the kind of boring fix of... Well, you get 1 point to put into. Sorry, you get 1 point of stat for 1 point beyond 800, which is a really complicated way of saying, like, for every point of Paragon that you would get beyond 800, you would just increase your main stat by one rather than the 5. And that would kind of slow down the benefit of higher Paragon levels while still giving you benefit. Dreadscythe kind of considers that, but then he also goes to kind of make the system more fun, more like have more things working with it rather than just kind of like a boring number change like that. And so he reconsiders something where people would say, oh well, what if there were just more options in the Paragon system, kind of like a Paragon 3.0. now you have more things that you can allocate points into, and then it prevents, or at least elongates, the time before you're just dumping everything into the main stat page. But he goes even one step further beyond that and says, well, what if we just get rid of the whole points thing and we just get back to items mattering, and now we can have these increased levels of maximums for the different affixes on gear.
So instead of like rings capping at 50% crit damage, they might roll up to, you know, 60 or 70, or you can even go through and take it higher. And so it just is, you know, it kind of like adds more RNG to the items with the range they can roll. So it does increase a little bit more of the hunt for having that perfect item, because your ranges are higher.
But also doesn't necessarily deprive you of power that you might have been used to, because you can still find like kind of the equivalent of what you had when you had all your things maxed out previously.
Yep. The one thing, you know, playing World of Warcraft, taking the conversation off topic yet again, that I really enjoy is the artifact traits. It's like a whole separate talent tree. It's like the skill trees that we had in Diablo 2. And it feels a lot like Diablo 2 in the sense that the grind is real. You know, it's like every time that you go through and you finally get that next trait, and then you go and you look at the amount of artifact power that it takes to get your next trait, and you're like, well, that's 3 days worth of grinding. You know, that's 4 days worth of grinding. And that it keeps, you know, increasing. And so you do have like this really big grind, but every time that you go through and you get a new trait, it increases your power. And sometimes along the way, you'll get these golden traits, which are actually pretty big increases, whether they're in healing, damage, or survivability, depending upon what your spec is. But it's something that you kind of are reserved. I know it's going to take a while, so it's going to take quite a bit of grinding to go through and unlock this, but it's something that I want to do. It is going to give me a benefit. You know, but it's like the long game. Eventually I'm going to have this tree maxed out and get all of these goodies. You know, and so it's one of those, like, the old, you know, kind of like D2 system of going and getting to 99, even though you won't be able to max out everything and get all of the toys, you know that, you know, and for some classes it wasn't even getting to level 99. Some specs, you know, you could go through and finish by like 80. And the difference between like level 80 and 99 in Diablo 2 was
ginormous.
Huge.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like you weren't even at the halfway point when you were at level 80. As far as the XP grind goes, it's just, you know, maybe it is something that they could go through and do that. And not having a cap on Paragon levels, it was kind of like one of those things. So you're always rewarded no matter what it is that you go and do. That was like the intention behind the Paragon 2.0 was that no matter what you do in the game, you gained experience. And so you gained a little bit of progress towards a reward. You gained a little bit more power by playing because I went through, I did a couple bounties. I didn't find any items that I wanted, but I got experience. So it brings me closer to the next Paragon level, which is going to give me some form of power and some form of reward. And that will be no matter what, because it scales infinitely. But at the same time, I think it also subtracts, and this is something I've said on the show before, it subtracts from that other aspect of it, of like there's a definite goal, like and with like the artifact traits, the old D2 leveling system is you have a goal, either whether it's being I just want to hit 99 for the sake of hitting 99, it's like I need to hit level 86 so that way I can fully complete out this particular build for this character that I'm doing. You know, it's like, so I had this goal that wanted me to go through and dedicate to going and playing the character and continuing to do the grind to unlock this special thing.
Huh. You saying that kind of, I think of a point that's related, but maybe not quite sequitur, not non sequitur, but kind of in the mm-hmm. house, in the realm. So it makes me think, well, when Paragon was originally invented and created, it was this thing that was supposed to give us something else to do, kind of a, like you were saying, a guaranteed reward. I didn't find a legendary tonight, but at least I gained some experience. So I got something out of that play session, right? I didn't get an upgrade in gear, but I'm moving towards more power and potentially the ability to find more items, because originally each Paragon level gave you more magic find, which mattered a great deal back in the day. Now, I think that system still accomplishes that, but it's gone too far, which I think is kind of, you know, we've all realized that, and that's kind of the point of the article. But what's more important to the player, or what, here's the better question, what should be more important to the player? Should the finding of the gear matter more, or should the leveling up matter more? Because it seemed originally the Paragon system was just there to supplement. It wasn't there to be mm-hmm. the end-all be-all. It wasn't supposed to be the end game. I guess basically there was no end game before Reaper of Souls, but you could say that item finding was always kind of paramount, was the primary thing that you were doing. And nowadays it feels like gearing comes like that, right? Like in the first week, mm-hmm. you're probably halfway ancient-ed out if you're unlucky, and if you're super lucky, you've got all ancients and they're all looking pretty solid. And now you're just onto the Paragon grind, and that kind of becomes the seasonal end game, where you do that until, you know, a week before the season ends, and then you just try and push your GRs. So it's mm-hmm. it's weird that a system that was supposed to help with gear acquirement, I think, went on this one path where it became like super easy to get, between the cube, between Hadrig's gift, between increased drop rates, between higher torment levels, which are dropping more legendaries, which are giving you more chances, between blood shards. Like, we have so many ways to get items, but only this one way, really, with greater rifts to get experience. Yet this is the thing that is reigning supreme and the thing that we mm-hmm. have to focus all our time on.
And I mean, and again, for some people that don't even go into it like hardcore, greater rifts is still something that they need to do. And so going and getting, you know, the pressure of, well, I might not be able to go and find, you know, that ancient furnace that will go and, you know, be able to like just walk through, you know, the greater rifts in order to unlock my chest. I still need to complete this, you know, this a higher greater rift. And an easier way for me to do it is, let me just go through and, you know, grind 60s with friends, gain a whole bunch of Paragon levels, and then it will make me going and getting that one solo faster.
Right. Right, yeah. It's, I don't know. It's, I think it's always one of those things that's interesting to solve. Like, do you want to solve Paragon, or do you want to solve the bigger problem, which is, like, what am I spending my time on in the game? And what are the proportions slash priorities? I think that's obviously a bigger picture kind of thing that would require, I think, maybe an expansion, right? Where you're introducing new features, mm-hmm. you're kind of rebalancing what players are spending their time on the most. Like maybe bounties gets this much X percent of allocated time for a player playing the game. Greater Rifts gets this. And then, you know, what are all these things accomplishing and meant to accomplish? How much of it is dependent on items here? How much is experience runs? And just giving us more options, right? Versus you have a system that's in the game and you could probably do little things here and there to tweak it. But at the end of the day, is actually spending that time on it going to be enough to where it feels different to the player? Like even if they were to change Paragon, how different would it feel when we boot up the next patch or the next season that, oh, Season 8 was way better than Season 7 because Paragon got all these makeovers, or would it eventually feel the same again?
Yeah. I think that, you know, I guess going back a little bit, your point there is going and talking about in-game. Because when it comes down to it, it's like you do have seasons where you do have a specific goal in mind, but then after that, you know, what is your in-game? You know, it's fun to go through and play and let me go and see, you know, if I can maybe complete like a Greater Rift 85 solo, or can I hit like a 90 or something along those lines, or am I just going to go through, play, you know, get my seasonal stash and then kind of like be done and wait till next season and then have a goal, and, you know, and then once you have all of your stashes, then what? I'm just going to play the season until I get the portrait, you know, unlocked, or am I just going to play it till I get like the special pet? You know, what point does your goal change or shift? And, you know, like what is in game for Diablo besides, you know, infinitely running bounties or infinitely running greater rifts? Of, is it that, you know, that goal of I want to get as high of a greater rift as I possibly can, or I want to get that perfectly rolled Gnat Slayer, or I want to make Shadows a viable build? You know, it's, there all these different kind of things that, you know, could potentially be an in-game, but the community has like this collective effort of, oh, the in-game is, you know, like Paragon 3000 and Greater Rift 100. That's in-game, and so everyone kind of drifts towards that.
Yeah,
like in World of Warcraft, it's like the in-game is raiding, so everyone goes and drifts towards that. But there are a lot more things that you can do in a game like that. And it's, I think that for like Diablo, like you mentioned, it might need an expansion or another game, but there's not so much that you can do without making drastic changes to Diablo 3 to diversify it enough to be able to like make a major change to the Paragon system.
Yeah.
Because it all comes down to that question of, you know, like what is in game, and, you know, what is it that people should be spending their time working towards, what goal?
I think they actually hit the nail on the head the closest for a diverse amount of things to do when conquests were also introduced at the same time as seasons. The only problem with conquests is that they last until you're done, right? Once you finish that mm-hmm. conquest, there's no reason for you to attempt to do more with a conquest. You're on that board, or you didn't make it, but you got the achievement for it, and that's it. I feel like if there was some sort of extended system for conquests where, if I'm doing Speed Racer, create a board that also tracks the actual finishing time, not just completing the game in the minimum of the 60 minutes, but yeah. Now if I did it in 58 minutes, 11 seconds, what if your team comes along and does it in 57 minutes? Well, I want to beat that time now, so let me try and optimize our run or try and get better RNG. And, you know, that you could spend a whole season mm-hmm. doing just that, you know?
That was actually something that I did quite a bit in MOP for World of Warcraft, because their challenge mode dungeons, which were kind of like the precursors to the Mythic Pluses, which in Legion is like a a nice combination of challenge modes and greater rifts, where if you had the fastest time on your server, you had a title that you could display on your character. So if your group was the fastest on the server,
that's cool.
You were like the Sunbreaker or something like that. I forget what all the titles were, but that was something that only you could wear. But as soon as someone beat your time, the title was taken from you. And my challenge mode group, actually on a couple of the dungeons that we liked the titles for, we got into some pretty harsh competition with two other guilds on our server going through and trying to see who could upset the others and get like the absolute best times for, I think it was like Skullomance and Gate of the Setting Sun. And that did drive us for a good number of months. Is just, you know, a couple weeks would go by and then you log in and it's like, I don't have my title anymore. I'm not a Dark Master anymore. Guys, come on. We're getting back. We're going
to get the band back together again, right?
Yeah, exactly. And so it's like just hop right back in there and you know, go through, and you'd go at it for like a week or two before you managed to like beat their time by 1 second. You know, and then I have very fond memories of doing that very exact thing.
Yeah, and I think if you translate it to Diablo 3, it would be another reason to keep like a different set of gear around that's not just your best set anciented out. Like, you might actually even put augments on gear for completely different reasons than just power. I can't think of ones that would work for Speed Racer, for instance, but like, if you're doing Avaricia, for instance, and you know you want to get the maximum gold streak to be on the top of that extended conquest leaderboard or whatever it might be called, Holy Grail or something. What if you're just looking for the perfect gold find setup that you can put together? You know, you want like all your secondary affixes with the gold find on them. You're looking for these specific pieces. You might try it on one class and then realize another class is better. Like, you could spend an entire season and have a reason for that gear to stick around the entire season, just to defend that title or just to see what you can do. That's not specifically about getting to a higher grade of rift or getting more power or grinding more paragon.
Mm-hmm.
It's just it offers an alternative. So I don't know.
Yeah, we'll have to wait and see what comes of this unannounced project.
And see also if there will be anything else really for D3. Like, how I think the next patch, I think we've said this in the past too, but the next patch might be telling, just in terms of how willing they will be to super tinker or only minimally tinker, or like just how much will they change things from patch to patch going forward.
Which actually, I forgot to put this on the show notes, but before we go through and move on to the community section of the show, I tweeted about this last week, and it does. Speaking of next patch, it's the end of September. We're 2 months into the season, which means we have 1 month remaining, and we don't have a PTR.
That's a good point. Where is the PTR?
Yeah. Yeah, it's normally, we have a 2 month PTR cycle. And so that doesn't necessarily mean that we won't have a new season, come the beginning of November, but will we get a new patch? Or will it just roll over and be a new season without a patch?
Ooh, that would be a first, right? I don't think we've had a season that has not had a patch attached to it.
Yeah.
Ooh, I hadn't even considered that as a possibility, but if that does occur, I do not know how well that would go over.
Yep.
By the tone of my voice, you can tell I don't think it would go over well.
Yeah. Obviously the patch is like this season ending and the new season coming to begin are going to coincide around the time of BlizzCon. So obviously there is something that they can do to go through and deflect the fact that there is not going to be like a new patch or new update for the season, because, hey, don't worry. We it's like, we've got you for season 9. You know, we've got a huge like update or something like that that we can go through and show off to talk about at BlizzCon. To deflect that, we'll have a little bit of a drought where we'll have a season without a new patch, which shouldn't really come as a shock to anybody. You know, 2 or 3 years from now, we shouldn't be expecting like a new patch and changes with every single season. It'll be more, it's like every couple of seasons there'll be a new patch with updates. I think that's something that everyone should hopefully at least have like kind of like internalized and accepted. But there is always going to be that knee-jerk reaction when that change does finally happen
for the first time. Yeah,
when it happens for the first time, it's like, even though I've been expecting it, at least, you know, well, personally, it's something that I have been expecting, but even going through and seeing it, and I'm like, last week I'm going and thinking, wait, we're a month and a half until the season's over, you know, and we'd have our new season, and we don't have a PTR, and we have like 2 month PTRs. So it's like something's got to drop soon, or what
not.
Does that mean? Yeah, you know, it's like, so it's still just, even though I knew at some point this would come about, it still is a little bit like, oh damn, yeah, it's here.
Seems sooner, you know? Sooner than you would have thought. I guess there is also the memory, because sometimes our best evidence is what has already occurred. And if you look back to BlizzCon 2015, you know, a big part of that was the patch preview for the upcoming, I believe, 2.0. I don't know. My memory's terrible. But that was when they were talking about the PTR that would start like right when we were getting back from BlizzCon. And that was like the reinvention of the Thorns, of the Invoker set, and like Shadow set and all that stuff. So it was kind of like a big unveiling for BlizzCon just to talk about that major patch and set dungeons and stuff. So I wonder if that's potentially why, like, you're making this point, but we could have a season where it's not going to be based on a patch, season 8, or they extend season 7, which is also a possibility. And then they use BlizzCon to announce, hey, big PTR coming, all these changes for patch 2.5.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, you'll have to wait 2 months. So season 7, unfortunately, will be a little bit longer than you thought, but, you know, get excited for these changes.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, like you said, we will have to wait and see, although the wait is dwindling down, hopefully.
Yeah. I mean, we're so close. We're gonna get, you know, obviously we're gonna get news about something at BlizzCon. About something.
Something.
And I'm sure if we don't have a PTR by then, we're gonna find out, at least at that point, what the intention is, you know, going forward for seasons and updates.
All right. Yeah, hopefully it'll be like here's the state of D3 and what the future might be. I would love that. Just to know something.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, like you mentioned, on we go to the community section. Did you have anything else to wrap up? By the way, we were talking, a lot of that conversation spun off of Dredd's article, and I do definitely encourage everyone to head to diablo.blizzpro.com if you want to read the article in full and discuss further, because we didn't hit on all the points in there, but there is some good stuff. So definitely worth a read.
Mm-hmm. There's nothing else that I had.
All right. Well, then we can officially transition to the community section. Wow, what was that? I don't even know what I was going to say. All right. First up, an email from Andreas. I feel like we haven't done this in so long that I don't even know like what I'm doing anymore. We have an email. Sup, fellas. So I was listening to the last podcast, and you were talking about new Brawl maps in other acts. And this is from a couple episodes ago, because we did some emails that had come in. We said we would delay to read until the next episode, skipping over episode 100. But yes, we were talking about some of the new brawling maps that could be in the other acts, and then he said they're already in the game, some of them, and you can enter when doing bounties like the Bound Shaman or any other where you can go through the red portals. Location portal takes you to what looks almost exactly like the D3 PvP arena screenshots that you can Google up. And also, I would like to share with you my first D3 screenshot from the open beta. Nothing fancy, but first is first. So can you showcase yours? And maybe some other viewers would want to share theirs as well. That would be cool. Keep on Demon Slaying D4 hype. So on screen, I have his image here. And he's got a Witch Doctor at level 13, clad in all blue items, with 3,800 gold on him, which is like probably a fortune back then.
Mm-hmm.
and a lovely stack of potions, because back then we actually had potions and they would upgrade as we leveled up too. You would have to find mythic potions.
Yeah.
Good times.
Kind of forgot about that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They weren't even auto picked up. You had to actually pick them up yourself.
Yeah. And then there was also the point in time in the beta where you could actually find scrolls of companion, so that way you could summon in like little pets that would also go through and grab gold for you, much like the pets do now, and elixirs that would like increase some of your stats. For it would be like an hour-long buff that would increase your stats.
Well, that would have been cool. I was always wondering if they would do something like that, because like they had thong potions and things in D2, like other types of potions that could be beneficial as a gold sink. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was actually, you know, briefly when I wrote for Diablo and Gamers, it was actually, what was it? It was Azure, who was also like a guest on the Diablo podcast a lot back then. He did his own site where it was like d3markets.inkgamers.com, where he was talking about trading and stuff like that, because he was really interested in that aspect of the real money auction house. I wrote an article for that about like the long-term longevity or for like the crafting system that you would need consumables in order to actually pull things out of the market and to pull gold out of the market to combat like inflation. And that if you don't have any type of crafting mechanism in the game to actually pull gold out, everything is just going to inflate at an insanely, you know, rapid rate, and it's just going to get stupid. And of course it did. You know, but yeah, not saying that my idea would have stopped it, but it's just like you had to have in order to try and control it. That's how like World of Warcraft does it, where of course inflation still happens in WoW and it does get stupid, but you have to have, you know, you have to have something that is actually consumable, not just like I will go through, pay gold to this person and get this item, and the gold just transfers from someone else to somebody else. That I need to be able to go through and spend gold to make this item, make it have an expensive cost, and then that gold is just then permanently gone and I'll never see again.
Mm-hmm. Or whatever benefit you get is taken out. Like if the items were to be bind on character and now you can't trade them again. Because that was also another thing too, where is you would buy an upgrade in the auction house and then you would just list your previous item that it replaced back on the auction house. So nothing ever really left.
Yeah.
So it goes. But yeah, thank you, Andreas, for that email. You are correct. I think you had mentioned it actually, that some of the old PvP arenas ended up being in the Red Portal bounties.
No, actually I don't think that was, if it was me that mentioned it, I don't remember it, because going through and, you know, reading that email, I was like, dang, I never noticed that.
Oh, well, it's true.
Yeah,
and there it is.
And then we've got two more emails here from Valen. His first email is, hey folks, haven't written to you guys in a while. Lots have happened since then, real life, I mean. Got married, found a job in the city's business, a management of residential buildings, at least for now, no kids yet. And of course, I haven't missed the show once since I discovered you and the other one podcast that's hosted by Flux. And then he also sent in an answer. He sent in an answer to the question for the contest, which we'll get to in a little bit, as well as he sent in two items for the item of the week show. We won't spoil the answer for the contest just yet, but he did go through and send in his own answer.
Mm-hmm.
And he did, where'd it go? He also sent in a follow-up afterwards that he would just said that he just watched episode 100 and wanted to say congratulations on our 100th show. Somehow I forgot to mention anything in my last email. You guys are truly awesome from the bottom of my heart for doing the show and keeping it up. Cheers and love, Valen.
Well, thank you.
Thank you very much.
I made a heart hand for you. Much appreciated. All right. Popping right along, we have another email came in from Demon808. He says, "Hello, Westmarch Workshop. I have been listening to the show for about 4 months now, and I really enjoy what you guys do. I just wish I had more podcasts to listen to. I have played since Season 3, and I always play the Monk, regardless if they're the best or not. This season has been pretty nice to me with the rise of the Generator Monk. I was all primed to start my leaderboard push, but I couldn't find a single Unity, let alone two. Sounds like Season 1 problems. After grinding up to 600-ish Paragons and still having no luck, I was beginning to get frustrated. I could not break the 75 barrier without the Unities, so I committed to just spending a day grinding solely for rings and no luck. That night, we got together and played in our typical four-man with one Witch Doctor, two DHs, and one Monk, so we can farm fast. I mentioned my problem, and one of the Demon Hunters says, 'Oh, I pull those all the time. I've been denching them,' which I guess is a term for unenchanting or salvaging, 'because I thought that no one needed them. My heart sank, but I understood that she didn't know. We started the grind, rushing through normal rifts as fast as possible. When she gets this ring, which is Unity number one, which might be spoilers, and I'm super excited as she drops it for me, but I still need one more. And then 10 minutes later, she pulls this ring, Unity number two, which she also gives me. And TLDR, I did not see a Unity for 600 plus Paragons, and my friend pulled two ancient ones in 10 minutes and gave them to me. And we do have both of those Unities featured in the Items of the Week section. But yeah, sometimes other people's luck is way better than yours. You should just take their items. Or maybe they'll be nice enough to give them to you.
Hashtag feed Nineball.
There it is.
All right. Our next one, this one's coming in from longtime listener, Sergeant Psycho. Sup, fellas. I'm sad to say that I missed out on writing in for the big 100. I finally returned from Western Westmarch 3 days later. Anyways, I want to congratulate you on making it this far and wish you many more to come. I remember watching all the episodes from way back to Westmarch Workshop Episode 1, Phantoms of Jar Jar. Back then, I was watching hashtag Blamarcon. And remembering not believing that people actually played video games online while broadcasting it online. I remember seeing each episode getting longer and both Nineball and hashtag Blame Archon both begging for feedback. I also remember the sense of community when I put in my notice for my time in the Desolate Sands. Listening over my time in the Sands helped keep some semblance of sanity, so thank you again for the book recommendations. Thoroughly enjoyed, even if I read it quickly. And thank you for the founding of the community that was always so welcoming when I returned to Westmarch. Well, thanks again. Happy 100th, now 101st, and may you have 100 more with 3 more changes in the cast."
Spoilers. He read the script. How did he get the script?
I don't know. It wasn't me.
Oh, shoot.
Well, let's blame Archon.
Yes. Ah, there it is. I heard he was throwing pages from the moon, somehow landing down to Earth. A little litterer, like as a litter bug.
He's not allowed to come back.
Not in my house. All right. Moving right along. Thank you for that one, Psycho. We have a passage. I have no words today. I don't know. I'm screwing up. We have an email. Let's just call it what it is, from Togaysnut. And he says, "Sup, fellas. I haven't sent an email in a while, and I just wanted to say hi, share my seasonal goals, and leave you with something to discuss. Patch 2.4.2 kind of killed the wizard for me. So I've decided to do something different this season. Instead of pushing one class to the top of the leaderboards, I've decided to get all 6 classes to Greater Rift 70 and above. This is also the first time that I've ever played the Witch Doctor. I have 2 classes left to complete, GR70, Crusader, and Monk, and this has made Season 7 way more fun than I anticipated. To accomplish this, I wanted to get all of my new bio characters up and running as fast as possible, and I've tried several different methods to get me there, and I have a few that I like the most. I'd like to hear your opinion on the most efficient and most fun ways to get an alt to farming status. Yours truly, Togaysnut." Well, he didn't tell us his method, so maybe our method might be his method. But I know for me, I mean, this is the reason why I often start with a Demon Hunter to begin with, because even if I want to play anything else, Demon Hunter is often one of the fastest classes to get geared up into a speed farming setup. And then from there, I can just get tons of blood shards, use those blood shards, and then gear up my other character. So you'll see, like, whenever we're streaming if I'm doing like 3 GRs in a row, I'll just save up blood shards, and then after the end of that third one, hop over to my level 70 barb or whatever, gamble, 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 all bracers or all chest or whatever I'm looking for, and then hop right back to the DH and, you know, continue until everything is geared out. It seems to be the most efficient. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just about to say, that's also the way that I do it, and that's what I feel is the most efficient way, because it's, you could go through and say, well, you want to play that character so you get more chances at drops, you know, but, you know, it's like, if you can only do greater rift like 30 or 40 with them, you know, you're not going to get that much drops. You would be better off just getting the blood shards from your greater rift 60s and then spending them on them and then cubing up stuff, you know, for them with the mats that you're getting. Is just going to be the best way until you can get them to the level where you could go through and then continue to run your greater of 60s, 70s, what have you, whatever your group's particular meta is running.
Exactly. Yeah, I actually have experimented with this because last season I did my Witch Doctor challenge, which was to, I had a DH, but I wanted to play Witch Doctor just as my alternative thing that season. So I made a Witch Doctor, but I didn't gem of V's. I didn't use any mats or anything. Like, I didn't, everything that my DH had found, I was like, that is the DH's. The Witch Doctor will fend for itself. And it took me way longer to get that Witch Doctor doing anything that was like remotely as good as my DH than if I would have just played on the DH and funneled the blood shards over. So when it comes to at least efficiency, it may not be the most fun because you're not getting to play the class that you really want to gear up and play. That kind of is the trade-off. Mm-hmm. Like, do you want to waste time, quote-unquote waste time, but have more fun potentially playing it, or speed up that time of getting it all geared out, and then, unfortunately, you're not playing it until that happens?
Mm-hmm.
Things to consider. Fun, it's like the quintessential question, right? Fun over efficiency. Which do you prefer?
Yeah, then that's been a topic of conversation on the show since the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Blame Archon.
Yeah. For some people, efficiency is fun. Yeah.
This is true.
Yeah, and then I believe this is our last email that we have before we start getting into the contests and items.
Yes, sir.
This one comes in from Guff. Hey guys, I recently become a fan of your podcast. I enjoy listening to your voices when I drive to work and home again. That's about one episode. He's got a pretty long drive to and from work.
Yeah.
I like the things that you are talking about and your ideas. It's a nice way for me to get news and learn about Diablo 3. I'm not playing as much as I like to, work and family, but Diablo 3 is still a great game, content-wise. Unfortunately, I don't have much time. I don't have much luck to get items to send to you. And then he also now sends in an answer to our question for the contest. Which, you know, we'll move on to, and then ends it with, anyways, congratulations on your 100th episode. I hope you guys will continue doing good, because I like them a lot. Best of luck to you. Regards, Guff from Denmark. Sorry if there were any spelling problems.
Shout outs to Denmark. Always cool to hear where people are from. Oh, yeah. In the first email from Andreas, he did make a call to the community. To see everyone's first screenshot that they ever took in Diablo 3. I will load mine up for next episode. I actually know exactly what it is because I've looked at it recently. But Nine, hopefully you have yours, and then we can get a nice gallery of them going for next episode. So yeah. People...
You want to put them together? I'll have to go through and check and see... Yeah, it's like I'll have to check and see if I have mine from beta or if I just have from live.
Yeah, I was not a beta player, so I have from live only.
Yep.
But yes, all right. So again, you can submit for that and all things community feedback at westmarchworkshop@blizzpro.com. You can also tweet things at us if you feel like being shorter worded or you just like to tweet. We can also read those and share things from that. And that's the WM Workshop on Twitter. But now the moment that you all have been waiting for, the reveal of our contest question, answer, and winner. So the contest, of course, again, previewed, opened up in episode 99. The question was, which podcasts did we hang out with at BlizzCon 2015? Now, potentially some people mistook this for, like, which famous people did we hang out with, which streamers, but we were very specific in which podcast.
Yep. And so someone even answered, you know, which episode of the show did we talk about hanging out with those people?
Right. Which technically you could have gotten the answer from that episode.
Yep.
But it was not the answer to the question, unfortunately. So just for the clarity of why the correct answers are the correct answers, it was all about the podcast. Who has a podcast that we know of and listen to, and who did we hang out with? In fact, we've even worn their shirts on this show.
Yes, that we have.
And so, of course, if you haven't figured it out by now, fake-ass drum roll, it was Cool Story Bro, the KSB podcast. Dean and Tim, the great Deanie, as he's called, over yonder. And so I will read the official entries that were correct. We have one from Steven, and he says, if memory serves me, I was hanging out with the two of you, as well as the gentleman from Cool Story Bro at the Slaughtered Calf Inn. So my answer is Cool Story Bro. And that's correct. And actually, this is someone who was a fan who was at BlizzCon with us. So that's pretty cool. Then we also had a correct answer from Josh, not Josh Mosqueira, but a different Josh, who wrote in and said, hey guys, just wanted to throw out there that I remember you spending time with Tim and the great Deanie from the Cool Story Bro podcast. And then, of course, we have one from Seb. And Seb says, oh yeah, he said, first of all, congrats, and et cetera, et cetera. And then his actual answer was, okay, my answer on top of my head for the virtual contest with the sweet, sweet Diablo pet is Cool Story Bro, a.k.a. Tim and Deanie, probably spelled wrong. Which indeed he said Denny instead of Deanie. I kind of like Denny better. Tim, you should rename Deanie to Denny. But yes, those were our correct answers. So we have three correct answers between Steve, Josh, and Seb. Now their last names, just, you know, I don't want to reveal them, but they have their last names. And so we will go in alphabetical order of their last names as 1, 2, and 3. And so Seb is 1 because his last name starts with a C. Josh is 2 because his last name starts with an M. Mm-hmm. And Steve is 3 because his last name starts with a V. And now what we will do is go to a randomizer, which I have here on screen, which will generate a random number between 1 and 3. And you can see here, it's not rigged. The minimum is 1, the max is 3. If I generate, it gives us a result. There's 1, there's 2, there's 2 again, there's 1, oh, 2, 3 seems doomed. And so now I will reload this page, and then I will put our things back there. So we have 1 min, 3 max. And the next time
Things are not looking good for Steve right now.
Yeah, that's very unfortunate. Hopefully 3 is is going to be the one for 3. So the next time I generate this number, this is the official winner. Are you ready, Mr. Nineball?
I am ready.
Generate 3! Oh, that's hilarious. Just when you thought 3 wouldn't ever be the answer. Well, there you go. So congratulations to Steve V. Oh, actually, I just revealed everything. Oh, God. Change. I meant to click this. Steve V, you're the winner. We will be sending you the virtual ticket code. By the way, that was sent in anonymously from a very generous and awesome person. So thank you very much. Again, you know who you are for letting us be able to do this awesome giveaway.
Is much appreciated.
Absolutely. And I'm sure Steve will enjoy the sweet Diablo pet and all of the panels that he can shove into his eyeballs.
Yep. And You know, this is just taking me a trip down memory lane. A company that I worked for would do like a holiday party, and there would also be a holiday raffle, and the big prize that they would have, like the biggest prize for the raffle, PS4. For whatever reason, it was a company tradition that they would pull two names for the final raffle that would both not get it. And it was the third one that they pulled would actually get the gift.
So like one and two had already left or something, or
no, it was so it's like, oh, they would the skip them. PS4. Yeah. They would go through and they would pull a ticket.
Oh.
And it's like, but they don't get it. And then they would pull a second ticket and you don't get it. And it's the third ticket that they pulled is the person that got it. It was just a company tradition. And so they would go through, and it's not like they would surprise you and be like that, but they said it, you know, when we go through and do this raffle, the first two tickets do not get it. It's the third ticket that wins the prize. And you cannot believe the amount of saltiness with those two people. And I can understand.
Oh, I'd be
because
so
that
salty.
Is the bullshit. That is like, what the fuck? You know, type thing. So that's just making me, you know, think of going through and kind of like doing it with raffle format.
That is too funny. Yeah, I would have been heated, super salty, because mm-hmm. it's like you won, you got your number picked, but you didn't actually win shit.
Yeah.
Killer, man. Sweet tradition, jerks. What dicks?
Dicks indeed.
There it is. All right, but of course we have not forgotten about the always awesome items of the week. And of course, we have some awesome ones as per usual. You guys always do a good job of supplying us with a never-ending source of items. So the first one up today comes in from Mad Hamster in a Hamstergram. And he says, howdy fellas, attached is the witching hour I found while doing a few bounties. It's not ancient, but it's also not too shabby. And I also want to thank you all. Oh, yeah, we read this part last time. I also want to thank you all for the podcast. They are appreciated. And I'm sure there are many in the D3 community who feel the same way. Congrats on 100 episodes. So this witching hour was rerolled to have 489 intelligence, came with 499 vitality, attack speed increase of 7%, which is perfect, and a critical hit damage increase by 49%, which is one off of perfect. Secondaries include... trash it, right?
Trash.
Secondaries include 152 cold resistance and two yards of increased golden health pickup radius. So thank you for that submission. Next up on the list is a compass rose that's ancient and was sent in from SOC. And he didn't leave a message or anything. He just submitted that. So this one has stats of 600 dexterity, which looks like it might be perfect, but you could actually go up to 650. Critical hit damage increased by a perfect 50%. Regenerates 9,722 life per second. A critical hit chance increased by 5%. 10% movement speed, because these do come with that fifth affix every time. Mm-hmm. And then a secondary of health globes and potions grant plus 34,233 life. And nothing has been rerolled on this, so probably take the movement speed off and throw a socket on there, I would guess.
Mm-hmm.
Tends to be the thing to do.
Yep, just so that way you have some, even just like that little tiny bit of life regen is still very welcome.
Oh yes. And then next up we have the two unities that came in from Demon. The first ancient one that he got from his friend was 595 dexterity, critical hit chance increased by 5%, increased damage against elites by 12%, secondary of 181 fire resistance, and of course that lovely power where all damage taken is split between wearers of this item, and he rerolled a primary affix for a socket. And the second one that his friend also decided to give to him was another ancient unity, and that has critical hit damage increased by 46%, which is the rerolled stat here, so that could go higher, a perfect critical hit chance increased by 6%, a perfect increased damage against elites by 15%, and then a natural socket and secondary of 197 physical resistance. So I'm guessing this is the one he's wearing.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other one thrown on the follower.
Yeah. Maybe his friend is wearing it.
They're actually sharing the way it was intended to be.
Yeah.
And both gloriously dying.
Yeah, it's like the way that the Unity was designed around, and no one does it because it's horrible.
Whoops. And then up next... Whoops, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was about to say, is one interesting way that you could actually redesign the Unity is that everyone that's using it within, like, one screen or, like, the XP sharing distance or whatever would just get a buff that gives them damage reduction equal to the amount of damage it would transfer.
Hmm.
It might be able to see that come back as a group build item as opposed to you have this item which works that should you would look at and think that this should be great for going through and having four people wearing them all to share the damage and split to make it a bit easier to mitigate and such, but it's only used in solo, not in group play.
Right.
But make it change it around so that way it actually gives you like a damage debuff or a damage or a defense buff for every other person around you that's wearing it. That might be a little bit detrimental to solo builds, but you don't even see Unities in solo builds that much anymore.
No, they're really falling out of favor. So yeah. That could be an interesting way to bring them back into relevance.
Mm-hmm. At least in the group meta.
Group meta for sure, yeah. Hmm. Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Might have to revisit that. All right. Next up, we have a ancient focus that came in from Valen. That was one of the items that we had mentioned in his email. This one has stats of 649 strength, just one off of perfect. A reroll of critical hit damage increased by 50%, which of course is perfect. Critical hit chance increased by 6%, which is also perfect. And then a socket came with it naturally. He also augmented for a 355 strength affix with Caldison's Despair of rank 71. And then the secondaries include 207 physical resistance and 7,694 life after each kill. So that is a really good focus. He must be incredibly focused to the point where he could have even sent in his restraint, but he was just focused on playing the game.
Focusing on the focus.
That's right. Oh, and actually there was a gem in the socket. Might as well throw that out there too. A Bane of the Trapped at 80, rank 82. Which gives you 39.60% damage against enemies that are under the effect of controlling impairing effects. Pretty nice buff.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was unfocused enough at least to send us a second item, which is a Blade of the Tribes, Ancient. So I'm guessing he's playing a Barb. Since this is a two-handed mighty weapon, with the DPS of 4,119.8, 9% damage for the affix there, 1,303 strength, 1,459 vitality, which is the reroll here, and then an increase of earthquake damage by 200%, which I have to imagine is perfect. I'm not super familiar with this item, but I think that would be 150 to 200 on that range. And then a Caldison's Despair on this as well of rank 70 for 350 strength. And a secondary of plus 24 maximum fury and the legendary power of Warcry and Threatening Shout, causing an avalanche and an earthquake. And then also, I believe, a Aramalama Ding Dong Happy Meal for a socket, which then has a max level emerald in there for critical hit damage increased by 130%. And Nine, would you care to take a guess at what our last submitted item of the week is? If you had to guess any item.
I don't know. Going by tradition, one might say it'd have to be an ancient furnace.
An ancient furnace! Did you look? You knew.
I knew.
Okay.
I knew.
That was also in the script. No big deal. And last but not least, we have a lovely ancient furnace, continuing the long, 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 long tradition of displaying any and all ancient furnaces. This one was sent in by Togay's Nuts, and it has DPS of 4,200.9, which is super high. Get it? No? Okay. And then a reroll of 10% damage affix, which is perfect, of course. 1,323 intelligence, a chance to deal 24% area damage on hit, and a secondary of monster kills grant plus 230 experience, and the legendary power that we all know and love, increase damage against elites by 48%, which is 2 off of the max. Exciting times with the furnace.
Very much so.
Always remember, never forget.
Never forget.
Alright.
What would we do if we're like 8 years from now and we're talking about Diablo 4 and there is no ancient furnace, but somebody sends in, you know, like a picture from D3 of an ancient furnace, would we still show it? Of course.
And we have to, right? It's written in the Westmarch Workshop bylaws.
It's a bylaw.
And you don't
I'm
go
glad
against
we were
the
thinking
bylaws.
Of the same word there.
I like it, yes. Oh, that's too awesome. Well, I guess we made it to the end of our first show in the new era of Westmarch Workshop.
That we did.
Series 101.
We did. And you know, admittedly, I'm a little bit shocked by it because I have expected to be dropped from this call at any point in time. I hope my audio has been okay because you've turned into a robot and cut out numerously. I just sitting here staring at the camera, hoping that you're not asking me a question.
You before you unveiled that, you were doing a very good job. There were times where it was a little robot, but no big deal.
Yep, because that was like that one time, you know, when you did ask me a question and I didn't hear it.
Surprised yep. It only happened once. That's good luck on our part. Good RNG.
Yeah. Gotta love internet connection. Comcast, Crapcast, Comcrap, whatever you want to call it.
There it is.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Yeah. Well, before you start our rollout, I just want to say for those who normally check out after right now, you shouldn't, because I have a surprise that not even Nineball knows about for the end of this episode.
Uh-oh.
Yep.
Uh-oh.
I just did that. Continue.
Well, you got me excited now.
Something from the vault, and it's not greed.
I see what you did there. Yeah, is it something that I'm actually going to have to pull up the stream? Because I just have the chat window open.
Oh, well, you would probably want the stream, but I guess if that's not going to work for you, then you can wait.
I can do it.
All
right. Is this something that we're going to do after, like, the outro, or what are we doing?
No, this is the outro. This is, like, as soon as you're done talking, this is happening. Just talk, okay. Damn it. Do your thing.
Well, I've got... Okay, all right. After a couple months of no new reviews, we finally did get a new review. So definitely going to go through and give props out to Uber, who gave us a 5-star review on iTunes. He did this back on September 20th. And he just wanted to say, this is actually the first time I've ever reviewed a podcast. Been listening ever since the first episode as I used to watch Archon stream, but always just as a quiet listener and lurker. After listening to Westmarch Feel Shop, episode 100, I had to spend a few minutes to give this show its much-deserved 5 stars. Really appreciate Nineball and Leviathan's dedication. I don't even play Diablo 3 anymore, but still tune in as it's like listening to old friends chat. Keep it up and looking forward to the next 100 episodes. So thank you, Uber, very much for that lovely, heartfelt 5-star review. And we do really appreciate it. Any of the 5-star reviews that we get does help us as a community. Other people will go through and be able to see it. We'll get higher rated as people go through and do searches for like a Diablo podcast or just gaming podcast in general. So it is something that we do appreciate. But give us whichever review you, of course, feel is that our show is worthy of. We do like 5 stars more than the other ones, of course.
This is true.
But also, how can you get a hold of us? If you want to send in your own items or your own feedback for the show, you can send us an email at westmarchworkshop@blizzpro.com. You can also go through and get a hold of us on Twitter. We're at the WM Workshop. And of course you can catch the live stream here of the show. We are every other Wednesday at twitch.com twitch.tv/blizzpro at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. While you're here at our Twitch channel, go ahead. We ask that you go and hit the follow button and check out all the other lovely shows that BlizzPro has to offer. Sunday nights is the Well Met podcast for covering Hearthstone. Tuesday nights is the Heroes Power Hour. We talk about everything Heroes of the Storm. And Thursday nights is the Payload, our Overwatch podcast. And if you like the content that you see, by all means, go through, give us a subscribe. It helps support BlizzPro and all of the shows and website that we have going on, which, speaking of which, a lot of the topics that we talked about tonight, you can actually find more in-depth coverage over at diablo.blizzpro.com, as well as more other articles from our team of writers covering everything from the entire Blizzard universe. We are even in-game. You can find us. We're the BlizzPro clan. We do have openings right now as we're the mid-season lull. If you don't want to leave your current clan, by all means, you can come through and chat with us in the Westmarch Workshop community, so you don't have to leave your friends behind to go and chat. We do have a Discord server, discord.gg/blizzpro, if you want to come and hang out and chat with us, as well as people from a lot of the other shows and content writers for BlizzPro. And finally, you can follow us individually on Twitter. I'm at NineBallGamer, and Leviathan here is at LeviathanD3. You also stream from time to time, don't you?
Yes. Twitch.tv/Leviathan111 is where it goes down, when it goes down. I'm actually, potentially, hopefully, doing something this weekend, which I think will be exciting for those who make it. So, tune in.
And with that, I guess we're done.
Or are we?
Are we? Dun, dun, dun.
I did forget to mention that the official Diablo 3 forms underwent a facelift as well. So the brand new design that we've been teased about for a few weeks now is officially here. So if you guys want to go and check that out, it's pretty cool. There are mixed reviews. But, you know, go and decide for yourself. See how you feel. But as we always like to do here at the Westmarch Workshop, we keep it funky and we compare the old to the new.
Compare. Compare. It's not working that well.
I was hoping you were going to do the compare thing.
Compare! Worst picture taker in NA.
I see people laughing, but my stream hasn't caught up.
Say US! Maybe you!
Goodbye, everyone.
This is awkward. I don't know what's happening.